United States of America.
Where is the North Pole? Buddy.
It's where Santa's workshop is.
My number two.
Okay, Flint, it's time for orthography.
What's orthography?
Upside down and trailing for a package of sunshine and ravioli, macaroni. If you want the thing you love, you must have a pizzaoli, baby. And when you hear thunder, don't run under a tree. Get a piece of ribbon
for you. Merry Christmas!
Now come over here, boy. And every time it rings, it rings. And don't you know it's crocodile?
Love you, Santa.
Every time it rings, it rings. You'll find your fortune falling. It's upside down to be live up. And you'll find your fortune falling all over town.
Buddy, what are you doing in here? You're not supposed to be in here. You have to go to the office right now. Come on. Come on.
Well, good morning, Cornerstone. Happy Friday. Happy Chapel Day. Guys, I hope you enjoyed that introduction. You know, a few years ago, we made a movie called Buddy the Elf Comes to Cornerstone. It is hilarious. And if you want to see the other kind of shenanigans Mr. Larson gets into, go check out the whole movie at our Cornerstone YouTube page. Well, guys, it's officially December, and that means it's time to put on my Christmas jacket. Oh, man. Wait for it. Here we go. Oh, yeah. All right. Well, actually, that means it's time for some December birthday shout-outs. So here we go. Happy birthday, Lizzie, Maddie, Elizabeth, Evan, Anderson, Chloe, Sydney, Anna, Catherine, Caitlin, Daniel, Adam, Everett, Zach, Kel, Alex. You know, Alex, you actually share a birthday with the Savior of the world. Actually, probably not. It was most likely spring when Jesus was born, but that's another rant for another time. Paige, Ian, Luke, Olivia, and Ernie. Well, happy birthday, guys. We're so excited. We want to wish you a happy birthday. So go ahead and stand as I read our call to worship. This comes from Psalm 40, verse 16. May all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who love your salvation continually say, great is the Lord. Well, guys, let's respond to the Lord with praise to all of his goodness. Go ahead and let's worship.
Thank you. giving my hopes and dreams to you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good. It's good. Today is the day you have made.
For who you are, you are good. So good, so good, yeah. Here we go, sing, you are good.
You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good.
Sing it again.
You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good,
Lord, you are good. Sing,
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Sing it again, Lord, you are good. Sing,
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation,
people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. Hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are.
For who you are.
For who you are. You are good.
Well, guys, it's so great to worship with you, and I'm so thankful that we get this time here together. Well, if you can't tell, I'm here in my home, and you know, this is one of my favorite places in my house. I'm right here next to the fireplace. I've got my Bible, I've got some coffee, and I'm ready to dig into God's Word. Are you guys ready? Well, if you're like me, you can't believe it's December already. You know, these next 2 weeks are gonna fly by, but here in chapel, we'll be focusing on the true meaning of the Christmas season. Within the history of the Christian faith, for thousands of years, Christians have actually practiced a celebration at Christmas time called Advent. Advent simply means coming, and within this celebration is the practice of slowing down and focusing our hearts and our minds on the coming of Jesus into this world. Advent begins the first four Sundays before Christmas and recognizes some key themes or truths that Jesus brings into the world. Now, some of those themes are hope, peace, joy, and love. Well, this past week was the beginning of Advent, of the Advent season, and isn't it amazing, if you think about it, that Christians all over the world, different languages, ages, skin colors, backgrounds, they're all practicing the same thing. The theme for this week is hope. And guys, I can't think of a better theme that this world needs right now. Well, you know, one of the reasons that I love this season is because of all the Christmas decorations in my house. Do you guys like to decorate for Christmas? I love getting up early and grabbing some coffee and getting my Bible and spending time in the Word. Oh, it's good. You know, I've got my coffee here and I've drank about half of it so far. And as we start chapel here today, I want to ask you a question. Do you think my cup of coffee is half full or half empty? Which one did you say? You know, now more than ever, I think we're looking at the world and our lives maybe even, and we're asking a similar question. Is life half full or is it half empty? Well, the truth is, if I'm a Christian, I'm neither a half full or half empty kind of person. I'm a person of hope. You see, because biblical hope isn't life is terrible, everything is not awesome. But it also isn't life is sunshine and rainbows and viral cat videos, everything is awesome. It's not either of these. You see, a half full or a half empty view of life is based on circumstances or events. But biblical hope, it's a vision for life that keeps my heart and mind alert to what God is doing in the world and in my life, even when it looks like life is falling apart. Well, there are a few key words in the Bible that can help us understand what biblical hope really is. The first word is yakal, a fun word to say in Hebrew, but it simply means to wait for something to happen. Like in the story of Noah, when he was waiting for the rain to come. That's yakal. The second word for wait in Hebrew is kavah, and that means to wait with anticipation. This word actually has its roots in another Hebrew word, kav, which means a cord. And when you pull a cord tight, it stretches and creates tension. And so kavah is waiting with anticipation for that tension to be released. Like in Psalm 40 when he says, I waited patiently for the Lord to help me. He turned to me and heard my cry. Do you hear the tension he uses in that word? Well, if you've ever had to wait for a medical test or a letter from a college or university, you know what it's like to kavah. As God's people, waiting is an important part of life because when we read the Bible, we see that waiting produces something that isn't a half full or half empty view of life. Waiting, according to the Bible, produces hope. It's not a hope that's based on my circumstances, but on God's promises. Well, let's open up our Bibles today to hear from the Lord. Go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 9. And as you guys do that, I'll go ahead and wait for you while I drink some more coffee. Oh, it's good. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 3 and then 6. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them a light has shone. You've multiplied the nation, you've increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. Then verse 6, for us, unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Guys, this is God's word this morning. Let's go ahead and pray and ask the Lord to speak to us. Heavenly Father, we come here now in chapel, ready to dive into your word, ready to hear from you today, God. And wherever any of those students and teachers, wherever we're at today, God, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would move in such a way that we would hear from you. God, we're prone to have that view of life as either half full or half empty, but what we really need right now in this world is hope, the hope that Jesus brings. And so, God, would you get me out of the way and just pray that you would speak to each and every one of us here through your word today. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the context of our passage comes from the book of Isaiah, and Isaiah is a prophet and writing right about in the middle of all those bad kings that we read about in the book of Kings. Specifically, Isaiah is writing about 250 years after King David, and guys, things were bad in Israel. Israel's kings and people had rejected the covenant they had made with God at Mount Sinai. They're worshiping other gods. There's massive injustice in the land, and Isaiah is writing to warn them. As a prophet, he was rebuking them for turning away from God and calling them to turn their hearts back to God and obey the covenant. The consequence for not doing this would be that God would give them over to the consequence of their sinful choices. If for you Bible scholars out there, what do you think they did? Do you think they repented? Do you think they turned back to the Lord? No, they didn't. The consequence then was the result of a brutal attack and takeover of Israel by the Assyrian Empire. Now, if you're a student of history, you'll know that the Assyrians were bad dudes and merciless killers. And this evil force would come into Israel and wipe out the region of the Galilee and take God's people back as slaves, bringing gloom and anguish and to all of God's people. Not exactly family friendly. This was the context of the book of Isaiah. And so the question that he's addressing is what do God's people do when life is literally falling apart all around them? Have any of you guys been asking this question lately? You see, this is one of the most tragic events in Israel's history, and it's the consequence of their rejection of God to be king over their lives. But is this the entire story? No. When we are dealing with the God of the Bible, sin and rebellion never get the last word. God's purpose in this world is restoration, and God always gets the last word. Go ahead, turn to your neighbor and tell them God always gets the last word. Amen. Come on. What was the word then that they were waiting for to hear from God? Well, the Old Testament people of God were waiting expectantly for God to fulfill the promise that he made to Adam and Eve, Abraham, Moses, David, to send God's forever king. The one who would bless and restore all the nations of the world and do away with the greatest enemy to humanity, sin and death, once and for all. This wasn't a simple kind of waiting. Like that cord that was being stretched and filled with tension, the fulfillment of this promise, it takes a long time. Lots of ups and downs, joys and sorrows, triumphs and tragedies, trials but testimonies. Throughout this entire narrative, God was teaching his people what it meant to have faith, trust, and hope in him, even in the midst of the darkest of circumstances. Which is why then, when it looks like the world is falling apart for God's people in Isaiah chapter 9, Isaiah reminds Israel, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. He's reminding God's people that even though things are really dark and terrible right now, God is going to turn the lights on. How's he going to do this? Well, skip down to verse 6. A child is going to be born. A son will be given. God's sending the true king that God's people need. And he's not going to turn aside and lead God's people astray, but he's going to lead them in righteousness and justice and defeat the enemy behind all of the evil of the world, sin. Next, a little bit later in verse 6, we get to see his character. Let's look at some of these words. You know, some of these words are some of my favorite for God's character. The first is wonderful counselor. You know, this doesn't mean that God is a good therapist, but rather that he's strategic and wise in how he will save and deliver his people. His salvation plan, it's wonderful. You know, the next word here is mighty God. This isn't a weak earthly king. This child that's coming is the embodiment of the God of the universe, the God of the Bible coming to dwell among his people. The next word is everlasting Father. He loves unconditionally and welcomes humanity into the true family that they've been made for. The next and last word we see here is the Prince of Peace. His reign means the absence of conflict, but it also means the presence of unity, friendship, and tight-knit community among all of God's people. All of this is like leading up into a big crescendo, leading up into verse 7. The ruler is going to come from the line of David. His rule will be defined by justice and righteousness, and there will be no end to his rule and reign. Somebody say amen. Because God is faithful. He never breaks a promise, and he's proven his faithfulness time and time again. So we're going to trust him and place our hope not in circumstances, but in the living God. Even when life is falling apart all around us. Well, God's people in this moment didn't need a, hey, cheer up, buddy, glass half full vision for life. What they needed was hope, a hope that pierces the darkness and lifts their heads in the darkest of moments. You see, biblical hope doesn't have to do with the events of life. It has to do with God's promises. I'll say it again. Biblical hope doesn't have to do with the events of life. It has to do with God's promises. This poem Isaiah is writing is calling us and God's people to trust God even when it doesn't make sense. Have you ever had to trust God for something big in your life? You'll know that it wasn't probably easy. Because trust strips you of all of the earthly things that you were filling your life with. You know, trust in a plan, a future, trust in health or money. Putting our trust in these things only leads to disappointment. Because the only foundation that can hold up our trust is God. And the truth is that there will be times in your life when trusting God, it's not going to make any earthly sense. And that's because God's plan is bigger and better than anything that we could try to write on our own. Come on, guys, we need to hear that today. How many times has God interrupted your plan because he wanted to accomplish his plan? If you're like me, the answer is all the time. The amazing thing about this poem is that it would be fulfilled in the most amazing and yet unexpected ways. 700 years after this poem was written, in the middle of the very region that the Assyrians brought the evil and darkness, God would shine the light of salvation through his one and only Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus, the true King of heaven, would leave the beauty and brightness of heaven and enter the darkness of sinful humanity so that he could be our Prince of Peace. How would he do it? Well, not in the way that you would expect a king to come. You see, this king wouldn't be born in a palace, but in a dirty stable. Later, Isaiah would write, he'll bear no beauty or glory. He'll be rejected, despised, a man of sorrow. We would cover our eyes. He'll take up our sickness, carry our tears, and for his people, he will be pierced. He'll be crushed for our evil, our punishment. He will feel, and by his wounds, we will be healed. How does Jesus overcome the evil behind all the evil in the world? By giving up his life to rescue the very people who had turned their backs against him. Do you know this King of glory? Who is he? He is the Lord, strong and mighty. And just like Isaiah, we're living in dark times, guys. And we're asking similar questions. Is God still here? And the answer is absolutely yes. And yet, we can't assume that our vision of how God is going to make things right will be the way that God works. Because like we've said and seen throughout the scriptures, God often comes and works in the way that we are least expecting. You know, something I've learned about God is that he wants to meet us where we are, not where we pretend to be. Now, this is where biblical hope comes home to sit right in our laps. Because, guys, let's be real. I mean, we go to a Christian school. We've heard these things. We believe these things. And yet, I bet for a big portion of us, there's this background anxiety where the reality of what we know and believe butts up against the reality of our day-to-day. And this is where I believe God wants to meet us. He's not afraid of your doubts. He's not afraid of your fears or your sin. He's bigger than all these things. Guys, look at your neighbor and right now say, God is bigger than all those things. Amen. Absolutely. You know, if we're going to be the kind of kingdom workers and ambassadors that this world needs, if we're going to partner with God in living out the way of Jesus, if we actually want to start seeing God working in our lives, if we're going to be the people who actually live out what we say we believe, then we have to start practicing biblical hope, eager anticipation for God to reveal his promises to us in this life and the next. Well, how do we do that? Living out biblical hope isn't something that comes automatically. I can say this from experience. Hope is something that you have to build and cultivate in your life. It starts out as a seed, but it needs watering. It requires tending to. It requires faith enough to say, God, I'm tired of living a meh Christian life, and I want to see you work in my life, and I'm willing to do whatever it takes. See, after belief in Christ, there's no simple solution for how each one of us works out our own salvation. Each one of us is unique, and no one thing will work for everybody in this process. But God gave us a clue throughout the scriptures and in the life of Jesus, and it's this: prayer. Prayer is communion and fellowship with the Most High God. It's the place where we spend time talking and listening, petitioning and surrendering. Prayer is fellowship with the God of the universe, and it's the place where he can do his work in our hearts, minds, and lives. Because the reality is that when life looks like it's falling apart, God isn't gone. God isn't done. And because of Jesus, God is with us. God is for you. Guys, let's speak these truths out loud together in God's presence. God isn't gone. God isn't done. God is with me. God is for me. you know, I want to help us practice this kind of prayer fellowship with God. And so to end our time here today, we're going to practice a spiritual formation exercise where we practice biblical hope. You know, so many of us have experienced pain, loss, and frustration this year. And as a school, we're going to acknowledge that in God's presence and practice biblical hope as we wait on God through His promises. You know, I know there are many more categories, but we're going to focus on six categories here this morning. We're going to focus on sickness, an unknown future, friendship, relationships, difficulty in school, and a kind of a meh Christian life. These are categories where we're going to invite God to speak into. So right now, I invite us all to stand, and we're going to hold out our hands as a sign before the Lord that we're here to practice biblical hope, no matter what the circumstances of our lives are right now. I'll lead us in the prayers out loud, and all you have to do is pray silently along with me if it's a prayer that you would like to pray. After we've completed all the prayers, we'll say out loud together, Amen, which simply means, I agree. May it be so. Guys, let's pray. The first prayer is for those who've experienced sickness. God, I've experienced sickness in a way I never thought I would. I've been sick. My family member's been sick. Help me remember that you are the healer. You took my ultimate sickness, sin, to the cross so that I could be with you. Would you please heal? And even if you don't, God, I believe that you are good. You are still king, and one day you will come again and make sickness simply a memory. The next prayer we'll pray is for our future plans that maybe seem to be falling apart or crumbling. God, all of my plans for after Cornerstone seem to be falling apart. I don't know what I'm going to do with my future, but God, I know that you see me. You know me. My future is not in my hands, but it is in yours. Help me remember that you are working all things, the good and the bad, together for your glory. When I can't see my future, help me remember the one who holds my future. The next one is for trouble with friendships or relationships. Let's pray. God, my friendships and relationships with others, it's just really tough. Would you use this space here, guys, right now, to just silently tell God what that relational hurt is? Lord, thank you that this situation is not too big for you. Would you please heal this relationship? If I need to forgive, help me forgive. If I need to ask for forgiveness, help me ask and make things right with that person. In all of this, Lord, help me remember that your word says that you are a friend that sticks closer than a brother. The next prayer we'll pray is for students who are having a hard time with school right now. Lord, school is really tough right now. I really need your help with this subject. Some days it's so hard to stay caught up with my studies. And God, if I'm being honest, some days it's even hard to come to school. You don't call me to be perfect, but you've made me in your image, and through Jesus, you can help give me strength. God, all I ask is that you help me give my best. And when that's really hard, would you put other people in my life to help me and support me? Thank you for daily strength, Lord. The last prayer that we'll pray here this morning is if you're tired of living a boring, blah, meh kind of Christian life. God, I am tired of a meh Christian life. And truthfully, it took a lot of guts to say that, but it's where I'm at. Thank you that you meet me where I'm at, not where I pretend to be. I'll be honest. I've been going through the motions. Forgive me, God. Would you energize my faith again? Would you lift whatever kind of spiritual depression or cloud that we've let hang over our head for far too long? And in its place, would you fill me with an awareness of your love for me that casts out any darkness? Because of your love for me, Would you fill me with a love for you that is bigger than anything else? And all God's people said, amen. Guys, if you prayed one of those prayers, I want to just simply ask that you share that with your spiritual formation group leader, or maybe even a friend. You see, when we open up and we share these kind of things, you know what, hey, I prayed that one about school. I really need some help with that. You know what happens? It builds community. It builds fellowship. And other people can join you in that prayer. It's a brave step, but I know that God will do something awesome with it. Well, guys, it's been wonderful to worship with you here this morning, and I'm so thankful that we have this time together. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Love you guys. Have an awesome Friday.